We are in our preaching series that we've been following here through the month of September and into October. And you might recall that the name of this series is Jesus Reaching, all the different times and places where Jesus reaches into the life of somebody and blesses them even as they were sinking into a dark place. And so you might recall that we've seen Jesus reaching into the lives of broken people and outcasts and children. Jesus reaching into the lives of outsiders like the Samaritan woman last week. Today, we're going to see Jesus reaching into the lives of hopeless people. And let me just do a quick little poll. I did this in the first service. I'd like to do it now. Who of you would be able to look back at a time in your life and you're experiencing something, some sort of what feels like a dead end or a kind of loss or some tragedy that has happened, and it feels to you hopeless, or you are at least tempted to feel hopeless about that? Can you think of a time? Raise your hand if that's you. This is really is a part of our humanity, or part of our human experience, that we would be at least tempted at times to experience seasons of hopelessness. And God has a word to say to us today about that. So would you join me in the spirit of prayer? Let's pray together. Lord God, we come before you now recognizing that in so many ways we are tempted by hopelessness, and yet you are a source of hope. So Father, because you are a source of hope, would you speak your words to us today in a way that will bring hope to life. Ignite that hope within us, and may that flame of hope burn within us, we pray. Speak to us now, for we are listening. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen. So the passage we're looking at is the story of Jesus interacting with Mary and Martha and Lazarus. And this is a long passage of Scripture from John 11. And so I'm going to lay my cards on the table. I've cherry-picked a few select verses to help us sort of begin to wade into this story without reading the whole passage. But then there is a section that we're going to look at a little bit more closely once we get into this. So Jesus and his disciples are a couple days' journey away removed from Mary and Martha and Lazarus. They receive word that Lazarus is sick. So the story picks up with verse 4 where it says this. When he heard this, Jesus said, "This sickness will not end in death. No, it is for God's glory, so that God's Son may be glorified through it." Now Jesus loved Martha and her sister and Lazarus. So when he heard that Lazarus was sick, he stayed where he was 2 more days. Let me just pause here a moment. Verse 6, the word "so." That word in the Greek is "un." It can be translated as "therefore." So that's that word "therefore" is indicates some measure of causality. So it reads this way: Jesus loved Martha and Mary and Lazarus. Therefore, when he heard that Lazarus was sick, he stayed where he was. He loved them. Therefore, he stayed away. What is that about? We're going to unpack that a little bit later in the service. So then he told them plainly, Lazarus is dead. They receive word that Lazarus has died. And Jesus says, "And for your sake, I'm glad I was not there, so that you may believe. But let us go to him." Really pay attention as the story unfolds. What is Jesus' real agenda here? What is most important to him as he's engaging this situation and interacting with Mary, Martha, and Lazarus? On his arrival to where Lazarus was, on his arrival, Jesus found that Lazarus had already been in the tomb for 4 days. Now that detail of 4 days is significant because the scriptures are trying to show us that Lazarus is not in a coma. He's not been drugged. Lazarus is dead. He is dead as dead can be. "Lord," Martha said to Jesus, "if you had been here, my brother would not have died." So there's a kind of an edge in Martha's words, isn't there? I see her kind of pointing and saying, if you had been here, like, where were you? You're supposed to be a friend in this situation. And she's upset. But there's also a measure of faith there. But I know that even now, God will give you whatever you ask. Jesus said to her, your brother will rise again. Martha answered, I know he will rise again in the resurrection at the last day. Jesus said to her, I am the resurrection and the life. The one who believes in me will live even though they die. And whoever lives by believing in me will never die. Do you believe this? When Jesus saw her weeping, that is now Mary. You see, Jesus moves on from Martha, has a similar conversation with Mary, covers some of the same territory. Mary saying, if you had been here, this wouldn't have happened. She starts to cry. When Jesus sees her weeping and the Jews who had come along with her also weeping, he was deeply moved in spirit and troubled. Where have you laid him? He asked. Come and see, Lord, they replied. And then the shortest verse in the Bible, Jesus wept. I've heard a million sermons on this passage. A lot of speculation, biblical, faithful speculation on why Jesus wept. And let me just put an asterisk next to that and say, that's all it is speculation. The scripture does not tell us why Jesus wept. I don't believe it's because he is sad that Lazarus has died. In fact, Jesus gets to work on this situation pretty quick. And it's not because of sadness. He's going to turn this whole situation around here pretty quickly. Then the Jews said, see how he loved him. They misunderstand what's going on in Jesus. But some of them said, could not he who opened the eyes of the blind man have kept this man from dying? Jesus, once more deeply moved, came to the tomb. It was a cave with a stone laid across the entrance. Let me stop there for a second. Where have we seen a tomb with a dead person in it and a cave across the entrance before? Bear that in mind. We're going to revisit that. Take away the stone, he said. But Lord, said Martha, the sister of the dead man, by this time there is a bad odor, for he has been there 4 days. Then Jesus said, did I not tell you that if you believe, you will see the glory of God? What is Jesus' agenda in this story? So they took away the stone. Then Jesus looked up and said, Father, I thank you that you have heard me. I knew that you always hear me, but I said this for the benefit of the people standing here, that they may believe that you sent me. Jesus is praying, but he's also got a sideways glance to everybody else. In fact, this whole miracle story is not only to bless Lazarus, but to bless everybody else who is there, to reveal something of the character of God. And the fact that we're talking about this now 2,000 years later, Jesus' sideways glance covers all of those generations as well. When he had said this, Jesus called in a loud voice, Lazarus, come out. The dead man came out, his hands and feet wrapped with strips of linen and a cloth around his face. Jesus said to them, take off the grave clothes and let him go. Now, what would God want us to see about this passage? There's a whole month of Sundays of preaching here. So I'm going to pick out a few things to share with you that I think are important for us today. First of all, that it's this. In love, Jesus allows us to become hopeless. Maybe I should have put quotes around the word hopeless. Because when we are putting our hope in the wrong thing, we are hopeless, right? When we trust in the wrong kinds of things and believe that those things give us security and hope and a sense of coverage, we are hopeless. And when Jesus stays away, even though Lazarus has been reported to him to be sick, Jesus stays away because Mary and Martha and Lazarus might be tempted to think, if Jesus showed up and healed Lazarus, that would solve all our problems. That wouldn't solve all their problems. What happened to Lazarus later in his life after this whole story happened? He died a human death just like the rest of us. Okay, so that's not what Jesus was about. He was about letting this situation get so bad that people would become desperate to reach out and grab a hold of what he had to say. And so the mental picture that I have in my mind is that you and I are floating around in the water. We're thrashing around trying to keep ourselves afloat, and we have in each hand a duffel bag filled with stuff that we think gives our life value and importance and meaning and security. And Jesus wants to throw his life preserver to us in the shape of a cross. But in order for us to grab a hold of that cross, we may need to go under so that we become desperate, let go of what we have so that we can grab a hold of Jesus' provision for us. That is an act of love when that happens. We may not see it that way, but that's how this story is presented to us. It says Jesus loved Mary, Martha, and Lazarus, therefore he stayed away so that they would become desperate to hear what Jesus has to say on the subject of death and life. And Jesus relates to us the same way too. Whenever we put our hope in the wrong things, Jesus may say hands off until we come to a place where we let go of those things so that we can put our trust in him. That's one thing that I think God would want us to see. The second thing is Jesus' real agenda. Is Jesus' real agenda to heal Lazarus? I think that's a secondary or a third layer of agenda here. But all throughout this passage, Jesus is demonstrating that he's got a different agenda. He's got an agenda of glory, making God known through this story and what this whole thing is about. If it were all about healing Lazarus and healing sick people, we could say that Jesus failed in his ministry because we still have sick people. We still have people dying. That was true in Jesus' age. It's true in our age as well. That's not his agenda. His agenda is making God known. Verse 4, this sickness will not end in death. No, it is for God's glory so that God's Son may be glorified through it. This is making God known in this story. And it's also an agenda of belief. This thread is woven in multiple ways all throughout this story. That as God is revealed, we are invited to a place of faith, a place of belief. Verse 15, I am glad I was not there so that you may believe. Right? That's Jesus' agenda. This story is here to make God known to us now 2,000 years later and to lead us to faith and to lead us to belief. It's not only about healing. It is, I think the healing is an expression of love and compassion for a sick person, but God has so much more going on in this story. The third thing I think God would want us to see is that Jesus is preparing for his most important work. That's why I asked that question, where else have we seen a tomb and a stone and a dead person? Because this is a precursor, this is a foreshadowing of when Jesus would die and when his body would be placed in a tomb and when that tomb, when that stone would be rolled away and Jesus would come out of that empty tomb. He is preparing us to receive that message and that this is a small version of the resurrection that would happen when Jesus was raised from the dead. So what's a faithful response to this story? There's several things I would highlight for you. First of all, let's acknowledge that in many ways we experience hopelessness in life. In fact, we should anticipate that because it is our humanity sometimes to grab a hold of the wrong things. And then we find that we need to let go of those and renew and reaffirm our trust in God. I've been a Christ follower since the time I was 16 years old. I've had to relearn this lesson again and again and again. When I grab a hold of the wrong stuff, I will become hopeless. And then I need to reaffirm my hope in God. That's one thing. A second thing would be that for every time it feels like there's a train wreck and a situation feels hopeless to us, just like Mary and Martha thought that this situation with dead Lazarus in the tomb for 4 days was hopeless, when Jesus is in the mix, nothing is hopeless. When Jesus is in the mix, you and I, with the eyes of faith, we can confront that situation and say, this story is not yet over. God may have a different agenda here to turn this whole situation around. So that would be a second response. A third one would then to be to develop the eyes that are looking for ways in which God is revealing himself, even in the midst of a train wreck. How is God going to show up and make his presence, his light, his truth, his character known in some fashion? Then there's this one question that Jesus asked Martha. Remember, he said, I'm the resurrection and the life. He who believes in me, even though he dies, yet shall he live. And then he says, do you believe this? I think that Jesus is here this morning, and that he's come alongside of you and where you're sitting, right there in your pew, and is whispering in your ear, do you believe this? Do you believe this? I wanted to share a story of something that happened in the life of our family this last week. And it involves my oldest son, Joseph, who's sitting right here. and I'm doing this with his permission, okay? One of the things that children of preachers need to endure in life is being the subject of perhaps a higher than normal percentage of sermon illustrations than the average church member. So I asked Joseph permission to share something that happened last Thursday morning. He's a student at Grand Valley, and Thursday he was driving back from Grand Valley and was on Leonard from Eastmanville to Nunica. So if you've ever been along the Grand River there, you know that's a beautiful road. It's kind of windy, goes through some woods and countryside and such. And Joseph was driving, and the car had at one point drifted so that the tires were on the gravel on the right side, and he overcorrected and turned the wheel real hard to the left. As I understand the story, he's now going down the road sideways, but also headed towards the forest that was on the other side of the road. And long story short, Joseph was in a pretty serious accident on Thursday morning, totaled the car, and the result of that was that. It was a Kia Rio that he was driving, which is not the safest car on the road, I don't think. It's a tin can, he says. But I'm sharing this story with you because in his telling of it to us, to me and Sherry, Joseph said, when I was in the car and the car had turned sideways and was headed towards the forest, I don't know if you've ever been in an accident like that, but time slows down. You can remember a lot more that happens in a short span of time. And he is thinking to himself, I may not see my mom and dad until they die and go to heaven because I'm about ready to lose my life. Somehow the car turned around and he ended up crashing into something on the other side of the road, and that's what caused that accident. And Friday, Joseph and I had a lot of time together in the car as we were driving around Muskegon. And I said, Joseph, I want to ask you about that moment, that instant really, when you were headed towards those trees and you thought you were going to die. And I said, did you sort of, in that moment, sort of re-engage the whole matter of trusting Jesus, that he's the Lord of your life and that you have a home in heaven because of him? Did you sort of renew that sense of trust in him? And he said, no, it wasn't like that. It was a matter of a certainty of knowing that if this is the end for me, and it looked like it was going to be, if this is the end for me, I'm going to be in heaven. This was knowledge, not hope, not a wish, right? So I'm sitting here thinking, I'm glad, I'm so amazingly grateful that Joseph's life was spared in that accident, but it's a whole different layer of appreciation to know that in a crisis moment, what was revealed in that crisis moment was a knowledge, was a certainty, was a hopefulness that even if this was his time, and it could have been, he knew where he was going. So I want to circle back to that question that Jesus asked Martha. He says, I am the resurrection and the life. He who believes in me, even though he dies, yet shall he live. Do you believe this? And I sense Jesus right next to every one of us, whispering in your ear, Do you believe this? Are you putting 100% of your hope, your faith, your trust, your belief in the only one who is worthy of that hope and belief and trust and faith? Are you hoping in Christ? Do you believe that he is the resurrection and the life? And even if you die, which you could on your way home from church today, even if you die, that you will live again. Do you believe this? You know, in this sermon series, we've talked about all the different times and places where Jesus reaches into the life of somebody and blesses them. And I sense Jesus is right here today, reaching into our lives. And whether you've done this 1,000 times before, or maybe you've never, ever asked yourself the question, do I believe this? Is my hope in Christ and Christ alone? Jesus is reaching in and wanting to bless you, to give you a future and a hope and a sense of security, so that when you are in your Kia Rio, whatever that means, and you're headed for the forest, and it looks like it might be the end for you, you will have certainty that you have a home in heaven. Do you believe this? We're going to end today with a paraphrase of the Heidelberg Catechism, question and answer number one. If you don't know this document, it's from about 500 years ago, and it speaks to us about the comfort, the hope that is ours in belonging to Christ. So I've substituted out the word comfort for hope. The original version is, what is your only comfort in life and in death? This is, what is your only hope in life and in death? And the answer is that I am not my own, but belong, body and soul, in life and in death, to my faithful Savior, Jesus Christ. I think it would honor the Lord. Thank you, Bernie. I think it would honor the Lord if you renewed your faith, or maybe if you've never done this before, that you would give your life to the Lord today. So let's say these words together and ask the question and say the words to the answer as well. What is your only hope in life and in death? That I am not my own, but belong, body and soul, in life and in death, to my faithful Savior, Jesus Christ. Would you pray with me? Lord God, we are so tempted with hopelessness sometimes. And sometimes we put our hope in the wrong place. And today, God, we want to put our hope in your Son, Jesus, the one who said, I am the resurrection and the life. He who believes in me will live, even though he dies. God, may that be true for us. Father, if we've affirmed that truth in the past, may you renew that. If we have never made that affirmation of faith, may those who are feeling something stirred in their hearts pay attention to that and come to you in faith. Lord God, you are a good, good Father, that you give us this hope. So bless us, we pray. In Jesus' name, amen.